So when we think about power, I think one of the things that I love and especially love with Aaron is that strength that you always show and remind us that the struggle with the transgender community is finding that strength and that power to actually persevere through all of the struggles, being one of the most oppressed.
I want to hear really from Shea. You know, she can speak to that. She has spoken to that publicly, and she has a great story, very inspirational. She's so powerful.
Okay, well, you know what? Let me go. Let me check and see if she's here, because you know I cannot wait.
I hope so.
Let me see. Has my guest arrived?
What y'all eating?
Oh, here it comes.
Here it is, right here.
Ooh!
Honey, that's what I came here for, you know. A little vegan little situation.
See, that we heard about.
Thank you, baby.
So what you have is a rosemary and apple roasted chicken with a sun-dried tomato couscous. And for the vegan, you got eggplant.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Enjoy, guys. If you need anything,
so
I'm in the kitchen.
Thank you,
y'all. I saw a video online on YouTube where you talk about kind of an overview how you were unwanted by everybody.
Yeah.
Ooh, baby.
And it just looks so different. Just being dark-skinned, being a dark-skinned
chocolate.
Individual. Chocolate.
Oh, come on now.
Honest.
Come on. Ain't no dark
honest.
And light. It's chocolate, baby. Right. I'm gonna lick you.
And so you know. You better talk about it.
That chocolate.
You better talk about it.
She meant it too.
True.
Pardon me, baby. I'm gonna be on my better behavior. Let me eat. Talk to us.
That's Cheryl. Auntie Cheryl.
Yeah, Auntie Cheryl. Nice to meet you, Auntie Cheryl. Thank y'all for having me at the table, honey.
Yeah, we're good to have you.
Because literally, if you're not at the table, honey, you own the menu.
There you
Thank
go.
You for inviting a black trans woman to the table.
Absolutely. Oh.
Honor.
Absolutely.
Honor.
So you said you were kicked out early on.
So I had to live my life in pretenses. So you already know how it is in black homes.
Mm-hmm.
We don't play that.
Mm-mm.
We don't play that. So we're not even accepting you being a gay person.
Hello.
So now come out and say that, listen, Alyssa Ma, I got another layer to add to that. You know, I'm a trans woman. You know, and so it was very difficult because, you know, you find out that you have to fight everybody. You have to fight the systems. You have to fight at home. You have to fight at school, you know. And so as you get older, the fight doesn't stop.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And so I was formerly incarcerated in a men's institution for 10 years.
You did because, a dime,
honey. Oh, honey.
4 years, 5 months, girl.
10 years.
You did. Oh. I did almost five. Gone.
Ooh, you did a meatball, what they call it. A meatball.
I feel you. And. Wow.
Yeah, 10 years.
Forgive the tears.
Oh, yeah. It was where I found my voice, you know?
Mm. Right.
And where I realized that not gonna get better. Huh. You know, that literally the same thing I experienced in the home, what I experienced is on the streets, is the same thing I'm gonna experience in prison.
Mm-hmm.
But now I'm not gonna be able to have the voice to say anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
So you get discriminated, harassed, sexually assaulted, all those things, and you can't say nothing about it because who's gonna believe you?
Exactly.
You know, so there's no credibility. You know, you lose all that. You lose your rights. So you
found your voice.
I did. And I found my voice because I thought I was locked up, but I didn't realize I've been locked up my whole life.
Mm.
And so now I'm just behind bars now. And so my locked up looks different.
Uh-huh.
But that's where I found out that I was free because I had that pen, honey. I could write.
Mm.
And so I went from writing grievances to writing songs. Mm.
In prison. Did you start writing songs in prison?
I started writing songs in prison.
Awesome. What a beautiful
Now, were you able
story.
To... How did you have to present in prison, if I may ask?
Well, you know, I got in trouble quite a bit for being myself because I came in as myself. So you're not going to punish me for my crime and punish me from looking this good.
Oh.
That's double jeopardy, boo.
That's double jeopardy.
You know? And...
I love it.
A sister can only take so much.
Come on, man. You don't know how much I understand.
You know, it's real. And so when you realize that your femininity is not enough, And your masculinity is not enough. Mm-hmm. So you say, where do I fit in between this male structure and this female structure? They said, you don't belong here, not on this side, take her. No, she don't belong over here, take her. Mm. Right. So I had to create my own lane and said, this is who I am.
Ooh.
I'm a goddess.
Ooh.
So yes, you can keep the male, keep the male and everything that comes with it. Because nobody can ever be male enough. Mm-hmm. Your male is going to always be challenged.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. You're never female enough.
Oh.
You're too strong, you may be borderline. Oh, you trying to act like a man.
Mm. Mm.
So women can't be strong. And so, as you know it, trans people can't exist in this world. So we've already been told from the beginning, you could be anything in the world you want to be, just don't be no girl. And so there were these rules that came with how we're supposed to exist.
Mm-hmm.
So when you were a baby, they said, okay, you know what? Oh, we having a little tater tot.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you realize that tater tot is not able to fulfill that role that you thought they was going to fulfill. There's not going to be any babies coming out of here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's not happening. So, you know, I'm sure my mama, you know, wanted grandbabies, you know, from me, but that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
You know, so there are a couple roles and a couple things that we have to do in society in order to be deemed acceptable.
Yes.
And so I found out that I would always be an outcast because I'll never fit in. I'll never want to dress like you. I'll never want to act like you. Mm-hmm. I'll never want to be you. I want to be myself and I want to be happy in that.
Where are you from, bae?
Born in Arkansas, raised in Memphis. Yeah, so they... Southern Belle all the way. And so, you know, it's just, we know how it is in black homes.
Yes, we do.
We know how it is.
How is it? Tell it.
Okay. So
extension cord.
We would prefer you to be anything in the world to be a mass murderer.
Ooh.
We prefer you to be a pedophile in the family. Just don't tell
Keep
nobody.
Keep it quiet.
But don't come up in here switching and twitching.
The first time I heard the word whooping, somebody said to me, where did it come from? Why we say, you gonna get a whooping? Why?
You know where it came from? It came from our oppressors.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And so we got our ass beat.
Yeah.
Slave master, whoop our ass.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so it was left up to the parents to get your kids in order. You would have to beat your kids. And in order for me not to whoop your kids and hang your kids up on that tree, you better go and take it to the back. And get that big switch, not the small one. Get that big one.
And draw blood. Mm-hmm.
And draw blood.
That's the only way.
But all these systems are meant for us to fail.
Mm-hmm.
How would you describe the experience of being transgender for someone who doesn't understand what that feels like?
Great question.
Well, for me, I find that people didn't disagree when the doctor smacked them on the bottom and says, oh, it's a girl.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the reason why I cried.
Come on with it, baby. Come with it. What you say? That's why I cried.
Not a boy.
You got it wrong. No.
And so.
Love you.
And so, so society tries to correct you and correct those who are your parental figures as well, because my mother. You know, I think for a while, when people pointed out to her, oh, you know, why is your child switching and twitching around here? Is your child gay? You know, and so as a parent, you get defensive because it's a black community.
Yes.
And so I found that my mother had to fist fight people in my neighborhood just the same way I did.
Mm.
Because again, there were people within our community that wouldn't stand for it. They looked at being gay, looked at being trans as a weakness. And so everybody said, okay, that's the weakness within our community and we have to correct that.
Mm.
And so when they found out that they couldn't correct that because I would put monkey paws on their ass. And so my mama would put monkey paws on your ass. Mm. They said, that family right there, there's something about them. And so, whereas we lived in the hood, and you seen people get dumped in the trash can all the time. You seen their cars come through and get egged on. You just seen so much. Their houses got egged in when you first moved into the neighborhood. But they didn't do our apartment like that because I had already fallen in school my first day.
Huh.
And so they was like, okay, no. 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 Leave it alone. And so what I did find is that as long as people understood that you would fight, And so for me, my existence mattered more than their idea of my existence. Were they willing to fight for it? And were they willing to die for it like I was? And so this is the only existence I have. I can't correct myself and live in misery like you. Because you were given a role and they told you what role to play and you accepted that. It's not my fault that I didn't accept that. And, you know, so I'm challenging it just by existing, walking out of the house when they say, okay, we're going to stop you from getting jobs. But then I'm still surviving.
Yes.
So my survival, I realized, was a crime. So in order for me to live like everybody else and be unbothered and, you know, and live my best life as well, I had to break the rules. And so they said, you wouldn't be successful, you won't go to college, you won't do this, you won't do that. And so my life became just surviving and not thriving. So I didn't realize I could actually thrive until I was locked up. And I said, you know what? I have nothing else to lose. Because once you realize you have nobody else except for yourself, and you realize that yourself is all you need, then you tend to come out with a different power. And so where I was looking for support before, and I realized in the inside I wasn't gonna get that support. So I said, when I come out this time, when I come out this time, a sister has nothing to lose. And so when I came out, I hit the ground running. Soon as I got out, I don't think nobody moved faster. I don't think nobody was engaged in more stuff. As soon, I knew I had a plan because I told people in the inside, I said, I ain't coming back. I seen a revolving door. I seen people come back, you know, and for me, in that 10 years, I seen people who came in with 2 years come back, get 3 years. Now you in here for almost five of mine. Is you tearing up?
Yeah.
I'm tearing up too because.
Oh my God! I didn't know y'all was crying. I'm thinking we just. I'm just going in.
Okay, girl.
You got out of prison, hitting the ground running, and you are performing at the GLAAD Awards.
I am.
Can you elaborate? How do you get out of prison with nothing, starting from ground zero, and end up where you are today?
Well, the thing is that I knew that I had this dream. I had this dream since I was a little tater tot. But it was beat out of me. I was afraid to sing because it was too feminine. I was afraid to sing at church because I would move my hand the wrong way. They'll catch me because I move my eyes the wrong way or my singing too high. And so for me, I always had that dream. So I would look at everybody else's existence on TV, Diana Ross, Tina Turner, and I would dream, and I would dream big. And so I would move myself from that living room into that TV screen. And so you couldn't tell me I wasn't on stage with Tina. You couldn't tell me that I wasn't singing alongside Diana Ross. And even when I got locked up, you couldn't tell me that my dreams weren't real until I woke up to that cold prison cell.
I hear you.